Being David Archer and Other Unusual Ways of Earning a Living. It was written and read by Timothy Bentinck. I've written an accompanying website for this book, which contains videos and photos of a lot of the things that I talk about. You can find it at beingdavidarcher.net. For my mother, Pauline, and my father, Henry. Introduction. "You're on," said the stage manager.
"What do you mean?"
"Tim Curry's got food poisoning. You're playing the Pirate King."
"I'm the second understudy. Where's Chris?"
"He's off too."
"This is a wind-up. It's because I'm 5 minutes late for the half, isn't it?"
"No."
"Really?"
"Yes."
"Seriously, they're waiting for you in wardrobe. You've got 20 minutes.
"Oh, my God."
"Cheer up, Tim. It's not often you get to play the lead in a West End musical."
"But I've never even rehearsed it."
"It's in your contract, love. Now, get changed."
This is what is known as the actor's nightmare, a curse we all endure when you dream you're on stage, either naked or in an entirely unfamiliar play, or having absolutely no idea of your lines, or bonking your leading lady stark naked in a spotlight with the whole family watching from a box. The nightmare was now actually happening. It was 1982, an eventful year. While playing the pirate in The Pirates of Penzance at Drury Lane, we bought a house in North London, and I also landed the part of David Archer, son of the eponymous household in the world's longest-running radio series, The Archers. At the time of writing, I've now been channeling this guy for 35 years. It wasn't what I set out to do. I've always been happier with the sword fighting, really. But I bless the day I was lucky with that particular audition, and not just because it's given me a measure of financial security for over 3 decades. I am now proud to be part of an icon of Britain, a national institution, and a source of excitement, enjoyment, anger, and sometimes visceral emotional turmoil for some 5 million people every day. So, I'd just come down on the train from Birmingham to do the matinee, having recorded an episode of The Archers at 9 a.m. The train was seriously overdue, and by the time I'd retrieved my bicycle at Euston, I was running very late for the first of 2 shows that day. The show was the West End transfer of the hit Broadway adaptation of Gilbert and Sullivan's classic, with Tim Curry, George Cole, Annie Ross, Chris Langham, Michael Praed, Bonnie Langford and Pamela Stevenson. If you ever saw that production of The Pirates of Penzance, I was the big bloke at the back. Until that day, when I was suddenly the big bloke at the front. I'd already done the movie. I was a pirate in that too. At the audition for the film, this small, wired Argentinian ball of energy, choreographer Graciela Daniele shouted, "I want 120%, you understand?" Luckily, I did understand, and because I was, and indeed still am, 6'3", and at 28 was very fit and had boundless energy, cancel comparison, I gave her 130% and got the part. Mainly because I didn't have to actually sing. We'd be miming to the original New York cast recordings in the film version. I had performed in Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat in Plymouth in 1979, but I have to admit I really wasn't a very good singer at the time. I got away with it, just, but always sang a wee bit flat. No one ever told me to sit on a note. Filming for months and earning pots of money. Nearly all the pirates and policemen bought houses on that film, for just miming, dancing and faux fighting on a mock-up pirate ship in Shepperton Studios, was about the best job a tall, energetic, not very good at singing, youngish actor could possibly ask for. Kevin Kline played the Pirate King. The inevitable and endless repetition of the scenes during filming meant that I at least knew the lines to the songs when it came to my turn to play the part on stage. The film's director was a man called Wilford Leach, and he wanted to do take after take from every conceivable angle, so the words were seared into my brain. When a fellow pirate, Mike Walling,
asked him how many films he'd directed before, he replied, this is my first one. Mike came into the green room with a big thumbs up. We're in the money, lads! And we were. What was scheduled as a 3-week shoot took almost 3 months. As Hollywood stars go, Kevin Kline is a diamond. When we once played a tedium-relieving silly game which ended with him getting slapped hard around the face, we all held our breath, waiting for a hissy fit. Instead, he smiled ruefully and said, I see. Subtle British humour, eh? He came to dinner with me one evening, and when a friend of mine asked him if he was in this funny pirate film with Tim, he smiled his disarming Kevinish smile and said modestly, Yeah, I'm a pirate too. After filming had finished, Graciela told us that anyone who could actually sing had a part in the forthcoming West End show if they wanted it. I auditioned, and I was laughed at. However, the being tall and energetic bit got me in. Hey, we got backup singers in Da Wings, Graciela said. 3 months later, we opened at the Theatre Royal Drury Lane to rave reviews and a sell-out 9-month season. As well as being a pirate at the back, I was asked to be second understudy for the Pirate King, which I accepted purely because it meant a slight pay rise. I never for one second thought that I would go on. My preparation for playing the lead in a West End musical, therefore, was, 1, I knew the words to the songs, 2, I had sung them at the piano precisely once with the musical director, and 3, I had watched the show from out front on a Wednesday matinee. That was it. Tim Curry's costume for the show was about as sexy as you can get. This was 1982, and glam rock and new romanticism were in their pomp. With bouffon hair and red hairband, entire tubes of mascara, blousy, frilly white shirt, tight purple breeches and waistband, and the coolest, tightest, longest black leather boots you can imagine, a fabulously flamboyant star like Tim Curry looked like a sex god. The problem was that none of his kit fitted me. It was far too small. So I didn't look like a sex god, more like an oversized kid in a school production of Puss in Boots. I have very little memory of that afternoon. But a drug called adrenaline came to my rescue all by itself. While standing on the prow of the ship as it hove round from the backdrop and the curtain went up, I seemed to remember laughing at the total absurdity of the situation. I pumped out my chest, lifted my chin, jumped off the ship, and my hat fell off. I strode purposefully across the stage to begin the first number and was hauled unceremoniously back by Bonnie Langford to where I should have been. This continued all through the show. Bonnie pulled me one way, Annie Ross pulled me another, and Pamela Stevenson ignored me completely, as she has done to this day. All the sword fights that I did with Tim I now had to do from the other side, so I kept missing the blade of the guy who was playing me. The jokey, ho ho, the boss has missed catching the sword, shtick, that the pirates all found embarrassing but usually got a big laugh, just looked like the understudy had screwed up and was deeply eggy. It was only the power of the show and the professionalism of the rest of the cast that got us through. Somehow, I survived. I asked the tech guys to record the audio, as I thought it would be my one and only performance as the Pirate King, and I still have the tape. I'm not great. I just about survive, but the cadenza at the end of I'm a Pirate King is a train crash. I gabble my words, and only through the comic genius and generosity of George Cole did any of my jokey sequence with the Major General get any laughs. But one thing you can hear, I did have enormous energy and apparent confidence, and that, if anything, can disguise a multitude of sins. That evening, Tim was still in, but Chris Langham was back, and so, as first understudy, he had to go through the whole thing himself, while I went back to being a pirate. By his own admission, he had an even worse time than I did. After that, a decision was made, probably by Chris himself, that I should take over as number one understudy. The costume department started the job of making me a pair of the coolest, tightest, longest black leather boots you can imagine, but this time in a size 12. By the time they'd done with me, I too had achieved sex goddery. Now I was able to rehearse the part, and I had proper sessions with the musical director. I stopped singing so flat and learned how to time the jokes. However, in Tim's continued absence, the announcement, "Ladies and gentlemen, at this evening's performance of The Pirates of Penzance, the part of the Pirate King will be played by Timothy Bentinck," was greeted with sustained groans of disappointment, which does little for your confidence as you stand shaking in the wings. Kevin Kline helped my confidence, though. I was faced with having to do on the West End stage what this modest but big movie star had done on Broadway, so I wanted his advice and phoned him in New York. "Are you paying for this call?" "Yes." "Put down the phone. I'll call you back." We talked for nearly an hour about how to do it. Timing of gags, thought processes, everything from how to kick a sword up from the floor and into another character's hand to jock itch, thigh boots, and makeup. Gold dust. Eventually, Tim became very ill and had to give up the part, so I moved down from the fourth floor dressing room that I shared with my pirate mates into the number one dressing room on the ground floor, with my own dresser and my name slipped in the programme. It was the same dressing room that had sheltered the egos and insecurities of many of the great names of theatre and music for hundreds of years, including, thrillingly, my direct ancestor, Mrs. Dorothy Jordan. When I came out of the stage door every evening, hordes of young women were there, throwing knickers at me and wanting my autograph. This was it. I was a star. It lasted about 6 weeks, which included Christmas and New Year. But one day in early January, I came into the theatre on a Monday afternoon, cleared my stuff out of the number one dressing room, trudged back up to the fourth floor, put away my sexy boots and shirt, and watched from the back of the stage as Oliver Tobias swaggered his way through the part that I had made my own. After the show, I walked through the stage door as he was signing autographs and fending off knickers, and no one knew who the hell I was. My first lesson in the fleeting nature of fame. Tasmania. I was born on a sheep station in Tasmania. I've always loved being able to say that. My father had taken his wife and two daughters there in 1950, and I was born in 1953. We came back 2 years later, so I have no memory of the place, but I have dual nationality, as do both my sons. When I finally returned to the land of my birth to do a TV commercial there in 1998, I presented my Virgin Australian passport to the guy at Sydney Airport. "How long have you been overseas, mate?" "About 43 years."
"Christ, hell of a gap year."
As a young man, my father Henry had absconded from Sandhurst, stowed away on a ship to America, ridden rough on the railroad to California, and become a cowboy. Then, during the war, he had been wounded twice and made a prisoner of war in Italy. Faced with the beaten-up, grey, broke England that he came back to, he gave up his job as a talks producer at the BBC when he saw an advertisement in a paper saying, "Jackaroo wanted on Tasmanian sheep station." A jackaroo is a farmhand and trainee. My father was a count of the Holy Roman Empire, and I am too. It was a strange choice. Bentinck is a Dutch name. We can trace it back to a Helmich Bentinck, or Bentinck, who died in 1354. There are quite a few books about us, but probably the most famous, or at least important, Bentinck is Hans Willem, later Earl of Portland, who came to England as the most trusted advisor of Prince William of Orange in the Glorious Revolution of 1688. There have been whisperings, handed down through history, that he was more than an advisor. This may have started because when the young prince was struck down with smallpox, Bentinck slept in his bed with him, as it was believed in those days that by catching a disease from someone, you took it away from them. Recent research suggests that while King William probably did swing both ways, particularly with Hans Willem's great rival for William's affections, Arnold Joost van Keppel, my ancestor was a rather turgid statesman
and, in the words of one historian, far too dull to be gay. This didn't stop my distant cousin, Lady Anne Cavendish Bentinck, when showing me the ancestral paintings at Welbeck, cheerily dismissing him as we walked past his enormous portrait with the words, "And that's the bugger!" When the prince was crowned King William III of England, there was a lot of tension between the English Parliament and aristocracy and the new Dutch interlopers. To help assimilate his court into their new realm, he handed out titles left, right and centre. My father was never clear why Bentinck was given the title Earl of Portland, but family word of mouth had it that, as the Dutch fleet sailed towards their landing at Torbay, they passed close by Portland Bill in Dorset. Turning to the ship's captain, the prince asked the name of their first sighting of England.
"That's Portland Bill, my lord." "Was is a bill?" asked the Dutch prince.
There followed a lengthy explanation, which included the fact that Bill was also a diminutive of William, the name the prince shared with my ancestor.
"Then I shall make you Earl of Portland, Bill."
Cue helpless Dutch hilarity. Probably the joke of the year. Endlessly repeated to hose-wetting effect at parties throughout the empire. This is the only known example of a joke in the entire 700-year history of my family, giving weight to the too dull to be gay defence. I've recently found out from the University of Nottingham that this is nonsense. The title was re-established through a connection with Hans Willem's first wife, Anne Villers. Also, the prince's first sight of land was Kent. Hans Willem's son, William, was made Duke of Portland, and his descendants married well to the Harley, Scott and Cavendish families and ended up with large estates in Scotland and Nottinghamshire, the seat of the family being Welbeck Abbey near Worksop. When the last Duke died in 1990, there were no descendants of Hans Willem's son left, so the dukedom died out. However, the first Earl had married twice, and we are the descendants of that second union. So, at the age of 70, Pa became the 11th Earl of Portland, a title I inherited. This came with a seat in the House of Lords, though without land or income. I'm often asked why not, and the answer seems quite clear. The deceased Duke was my father's sixth cousin twice removed. Would you expect to inherit anything from your sixth cousin twice removed? Do you even know who any of your sixth cousins twice removed are, or what twice removed actually means? It does, however, explain why I'm a jobbing actor and not managing an estate from a Subaru. So we are a family of counts. The Holy Roman Empire bit is complicated but doesn't mean Catholic. My Protestant great-grandfather was so formidably religious, he gave up his Dutch castle and his entire inheritance for his belief. His son, my grandfather, was too dim to get the connection and continued being a slave to Jesus. My grandmother came from the Catholic Noel family, who disinherited her when she married a Protestant. When your father's the Earl of Gainsborough, being disinherited by him makes a difference. My father was therefore brought up by these impoverished, warring Christian parents who had lost everything in the name of the Lord, and understandably, the moment he became sentient, he also became a staunch atheist. He married the daughter of a Yorkshire industrialist whose business had gone down the Swanee, which makes me a nicely mongreled half-Toff, half-Sheffield Steel. My father's parents both died before he was out of his teens, and what bits of family stuff that were left, such as a house, some Gainsboroughs, a Titian and a Romney, were all sold by my sweet but totally naive great-uncle Arthur for practically nothing. He had become my father's guardian, and he basically sold the entire inheritance in order to pay the death duties. Arthur's famous sayings have lived on, but his dismissal of these treasures with the words, "Not worth much, a few paintings and a bit of rough shooting for the boy," has lived on in infamy. It should be said that Arthur was also pretty much responsible for the Iraq wars, having been an important part of the British mandate that drew a straight line between Iraq, Kurdistan and Turkey. As we know, this led to more than just a bit of rough shooting. Arthur took his role as guardian very seriously. He once collected Pa from a party in Belgravia, from where they were due to drive to Scotland, in his beautiful Lagonda. As they were walking towards the car, a pretty young French girl asked my father for directions.
In the 30s, there were a lot of prostitutes in London, and a great many of them were French. Fearing the worst, Arthur grabbed Pa in the middle of his explanation to this perfectly innocent tourist, threw him into the car, reversed into a taxi, and sped off into the night, engine roaring. They drove in silence until they got to the A1, the romantically named Great North Road, when Arthur said,
"Now look here, Henry."
This usually presaged trouble.
"Were there girls at this party?"
"Yes, Uncle Arthur, of course there were girls." They continued to travel in strained silence until they reached Scotch Corner about 8 hours later, when Arthur, who could contain himself no longer, suddenly shouted very loudly,
"Did they show their breasts?"
Arthur was a tragic relic of an aristocratic Edwardian childhood, who, despite being a highly decorated Major General in the Coldstream Guards, badly wounded in the Boer and Great Wars, was quite simply out of his depth in the meritocratic 20th century. One evening, Arthur had got tickets for a West End show. When they couldn't get a taxi, Pa suggested they take a bus. Arthur had never been on a bus in his life. When they got on, Arthur said to the conductor,
"Do you go to Piccadilly Circus?"
The fact that the number 42 had Piccadilly Circus written on the front of it hadn't registered with him.
"Yes, we do," answered the conductor patiently. "Will you take us?"
asked Arthur, kindly. The fare was tuppence each, so Arthur gave the conductor sixpence and told him to keep the change. I was brought up with these tales of odd relations. Arthur's sister Ursula drove round Europe in a VW Beetle, teaching the word of the Lord. She never discovered fourth gear, so was a serious danger on speed limit-free autobahns going flat out in third in the fast lane, about 40. She picked up every hitchhiker she passed, and one day a young man threatened her with a knife. She calmly pulled over to the hard shoulder, leant across him to the glove box, got out a Bible and gave it to the perplexed would-be mugger with the words,
"No, I don't believe you have read this. I want you to get out now, take this Bible with you, and when you have studied it thoroughly, come back to me and we will talk further. My address is on the flyleaf."
My great-aunts and uncles were all devoted to God in such an all-embracing way that their own lives, education, intellect and possessions were entirely secondary to their faith, which is why my father was so frustrated that he had no one in the family who he liked talking to, and the ones he did have anything to do with had managed to throw away his entire inheritance out of sheer ignorance. So, when my parents left for Australia in 1950, they took just one crate of paintings and furniture to a modest settlement in the Midlands of Tasmania. One crate. This was all this nouveau pauvre aristocrat had been left after a succession of forebears had managed to lose great castles full of the stuff. So I was born in a small hospital in Campbelltown, Tasmania, on the 1st of June 1953. As my family returned to England just 2 years later, the Australian adventure was like a part of my life that I'd completely missed out on. There were endless family stories of hupmobiles and corrugated roads, of riding fast horses and climbing mountains, and two photograph albums of black and white pictures taken on my mum's box brownie camera, with me as a baby in this wonderful place that, to me, was so far away it might have been on Mars. My elder sisters, Sorrel and Anna, were full of memories, but I had none. When I did finally get back there some 40 years later, I walked up the path to the hospital and approached the receptionist. She looked up at me and immediately said, "Oh, are you Tim Bentinck?" I was shocked. Had my birth made that much impression? It turned out that she was the wife of the old friend of the family with whom I'd arranged to stay that night. When I asked her which room I'd been born in, she told me that the old maternity ward had been knocked down years before. She pointed out of the window at the car park.
"You'd have probably been born just underneath that little red Mazda over there."
Wandering around Barton, the sheep station where we lived, about 10 miles north of Campbelltown, I matched the locations of all the black and white photos of me as a baby to their present-day reality. The place was just the same, but in colour. When I dived into Broadwater, the wide, deep part of the river that ran through the estate, I saw, in my mind, the photo of me floating there aged one with my pa, and it completed a circle, restoring part of my childhood. The owners kindly left me to my own thoughts, which were sad and jumbled and confused. I tried to picture my mum, naughty, funny, sexy, smoky Pauline Mellows from Yorkshire, the aesthete, the jazz lover, singer, writer, the play-loving, pretty one, as described by her older sister Pinky. What on earth would she have made of sheep-shearing Aussie farmers, stuck in the heat in the middle of nowhere with no one to talk to, two young children and a baby on the way? How had my father persuaded her? He was always thinking ahead, and in the post-war years, with the fear of MAD, mutually assured destruction, he had read somewhere that the only place in the world that would be almost free from the resultant radiation was Tasmania. That's why he went. In doing so, he made what became known as Pa's great mistake. As far as I can make out, when Pa, broke aristocrat, married Mum, daughter of once wealthy Yorkshire industrialist, said industrialist gave his daughter a sum of money to be used to buy a house. This money was in a form of trust called a marriage settlement, administered by a law firm called Bird and Bird, names which I heard my parents utter in the same way a Jewish family might refer to Himmler. Ever a one for the greater picture, and often impatient with the petty details, like contracts, Pa's great mistake was not to read the small print. He was going off to Tassie to be a farm labourer, but that was just while he pursued his real goal. He was out there to buy a farm with thousands of acres, ride the range, and start a dynasty. The small print, however, decreed that any property purchased with said settlement was to be, quote, within the borders of the United Kingdom, unquote. The pragmatic Grandpa Mellows didn't trust this intellectual, flighty, handsome southern fop, and wasn't about to see his daughter whisked off to the colonies. That's why Pa stayed a jackaroo for 4 years. Twit. So, in 1955, he made an enormous crate out of Tasmanian oak, painted H.B. London on the side of it, filled it with all the family furniture and paintings, and came home. I know this because there's a photo of him up a ladder painting the words on the crate. After he died of cancer in 1997, I inherited his enormous book collection, the bookshelves of which were made from this packing case. As I was dismantling them and stacking them together, I found the shelves with the writing on them, which was impossibly moving. Berkhamsted. Back in England, my parents rented a house in Finchley while they went house hunting. In fact, house hunting was one of the first phrases I remember, because that's all the grown-ups seemed to do all day. I used to wonder what sort of house they would eventually catch, and whether or not it might be a dangerous sort of house once they'd found it. It turned out to be quite benign, a four-bedroom detached house called Thorn Bank in a quarter acre of garden just outside a village called Potten End near Berkhamsted. The garden was my playground, my fantasy world, with a sandpit and Wendy house, where I built camps and treehouses, and later a stage with a curtain for putting on plays that I had written. The kitchen, where we ate, was the scene of great philosophical debates with my parents' friends and sisters' boyfriends, with diagrams written in pencil on the blue formica top of the dining table. It was also the place where, in January 1967, waiting to be taken back for my second term at boarding school, my father came downstairs and told me that my mother was dead. She had taken an overdose. I still don't know why they never gave her a funeral. Until that day, my childhood had been pretty happy. After a rocky first day at a kindergarten called Rothsay in Berkhamsted, when I refused to let go of my father's hand and had to be dragged screaming into morning prayers, I settled down to a life of conkers, marbles, swimming, fighting, and football. I do have some vague memories of sitting in classrooms while formidable women called Miss and dotty old gents with military titles droned on about things that scared me stiff because I didn't understand them, like maths. which is odd given my later utter delight in computer programming. There are certain smells that take me straight back to my school days. Rothsay is wet leaves on new tarmac. They had just relaid the playground when I arrived. Berkhamsted Prep School is wet, white, woolen, polo neck jerseys after games. And Harrow is an incriminating mixture of cigarettes and burning electrical motors from the overworked Ventaxia extractor fan in the first floor bogs. The countryside around our house was beautiful, and for an adventurous child it was a bucolic idyll, of which I was the king, and my bicycle was a thoroughbred charger. I biked everywhere. My best friend Johns, his name was Johnson Merricks, a moniker with which his mother used to assault him in full when angry. He's been a relieved John for a while now, and I used to build camps. Our playground was a mixture of the paths, bracken and woods of common land, and the bicycling heaven of the fairways and bunkers of the local golf course. The area had been used to train the troops before they set off for the front in the Great War, so it was dotted with zigzag trenches, foxholes, slit trenches and bomb craters. Our camps were made by covering these holes with branches and leaves, a technique learned from poo when making heffalump traps. I can't really remember what we did when inside them. We were too young to smoke. Maybe it was a desire to return to the womb, or an early manifestation of nest building, a trait which has been an important part of my life. Building a home, making things, repairing, being practical. Basically, it was nine-year-old DIY. I loved my bike for the total freedom it gave me. Some of the shell craters made amazing bike courses, like modern-day skateboard parks, and we'd spend hours finessing our techniques and timing our runs. I used to bicycle to school, which in the morning meant crossing the common, then a death-defyingly fast downhill run of about a mile past the Norman Berkhamsted Castle and into the town. Going back was a grinding slog, but my God, I was fit. My first bike was a second-hand bone shaker, but putting black-and-white check tape down the side made it go like a rocket. When I was finally given a new one, a Rally 3-speed, the twist-grip gears were about the most futuristic, coolest things I had ever seen. It felt like being on a motorbike. I learned to do wheelies, and I saved up my pocket money to get special off-road tyres, which slowed the bike down a lot, but looked great when covered with mud. Instant smell memory, 3-in-1 oil. I never knew what three things it did, but the fact that you were getting three things for the price of one made it important, grown up, and highly technical. A must for boys who wanted to be spaceship pilots like Dan Dare, racing drivers like Stirling Moss, pilots like Biggles, or land speed record holders like Malcolm Campbell. A world of fantasy and invention. The joy of Wednesdays when the Eagle comic would arrive, and the sadness of Thursdays, knowing you had another whole week to wait for the next one. We would watch Doctor Who, Robin Hood, and westerns, classic black-and-white cowboy shows on a small screen. I'd lie on the floor about a foot from the tiny TV and live every minute of Bronco Lane, Rawhide, The Lone Ranger, and Bonanza. And, as you only saw it the once, no replay, no catch-up, you had to literally replay it yourself. So I'd strap on my six-gun, pull on my chaps, slip on my waistcoat and flip on my Stetson. With my trusty steed, Rally Roadster, I was ready. First, I had to check for engines. Keeping low, I gained the cover of the hedge. From there, I made my way slowly and quietly to the top of the garden and the overhanging bough that I could climb up to reach the extensive camouflage treehouse I had built. I could reconnoitre the whole garden, judging whether it would be safe to continue the mission on to the Wendy house. To keep ready for any trouble, I would practice my quick draw. Johns and I would have shootouts, and of course whoever went pew, pew first won. I became lethally quick. I was like the gunfighter Johnny Ringo. This skill was to bear fruit some 40 years later when I was in a Western myself. The problem was I couldn't stop going pew, pew, even in tight close-up. Some things are ingrained. We had a beagle called Jasper, and a black cat called Uspu. Jasper was great. He could roam free and would be called back for food in the evening with a bugle. That's why I can play the bugle. Again, nothing wasted. One day he came back in the van of a farmer who said the next time he chased his bloody sheep, he'd shoot the bastard hound. As a result, I have a vague recollection of taking Jasper for a walk through a field, showing him a sheep and saying, "No. Understand? No." My first pay job was working on a farm in Nettleden. This gave me the farming experience I still use in my imagination for the Archers, and in my mind, the farm remains the location of the yard at Brookfield. Later, when my father and stepmother created an organic smallholding in Devon, I did more farm work, but the traditional family farm at Nettleden, with its cows, sheep, and pigs, is also a great source of inspiration. There was a big bloke with massive sideburns and a strong old Hertfordshire accent called Jess, and a weaselly naughty kid called Nobby, who used to take me out poaching. All my scenes with Jethro and later Bert Fry have resonances with those two, and that's where I learnt to drive a tractor, muck out a pigsty, build a barbed wire fence, I have the scars to prove it, toss a bale to the top of a haystack, and roll a crafty fag. I've always been able to imagine a mile in my head because just down the road from our house was the Mad Mile, a stretch of almost straight country road, on which my father and later I used to test the speed of our beetle. The answer was always the same, about 68 miles an hour, top whack. His other trick was to see how late he could leave it before braking for the T-junction. He'd worked out that if he hit the anchors at the second he passed the T-junction sign, he'd stop just in time. One night he was returning from work, over the limit, the norm in those days, missed the sign due to thick fog, and went straight through the fence at the end and into a field. The barbed wire on the top of the fence ripped the sunshine roof clean off, and the rest of the car was battered and bruised. In the morning, when I got up to find the pitiable remains of my favourite thing in the world, I stormed into my parents' bedroom, purple with rage and streaming tears, and shouted, "What have you done to Folksy?" A few days later, no doubt to make up for his idiocy, Pa bought me a toy beetle. Not a corgi, dinky, or matchbox, but a large, blue, beautiful model with a pull-back engine and opening doors. Within a week, I had taken a hammer to it and bashed it to make it look like our own. I have it still. It was typical of my father that, having gone through a war where the Germans had nearly killed him, taken him prisoner, and amused themselves by subjecting him to a mock execution, the first car he had bought when he got back from Tassie was Hitler's iconic people's car, the VW Beetle. Compared to everything else on the road in the late 50s, it looked like a spaceship. Pa was fascinated by modern things and the future, so to him it made perfect sense. Crowds would gather when we stopped at traffic lights, asking what on earth it was. It was metallic bronze, and I was brought up to the sound of its air-cooled flat-four engine, as my place was the back-back, the luggage space behind the back seat, which was like a cot, and I would sleep there on long journeys. And boy, did we have some long journeys. Every Christmas, we would drive up to visit our cousins in Forfar, Scotland. It's only an 8-hour drive these days, but in the 1960s, it meant a marathon journey on the Great North Road with a family of five and all their clothes, plus Christmas presents, jammed into a tiny beetle with an underpowered 1200cc engine and a 6-volt battery. The headlights were only slightly brighter than candles, but we would drive through the whole night, often in freezing hail, fog, or snow. One time it was so cold that the windscreen wipers froze up, and my father, damned if he was going to stop because he'd managed to overtake a lorry 4 miles back after an hour of trying, got my mum to stick her head up through the sunshine roof to free the wipers. The reason we had all managed to fit in the car was because my mother had won the packing prize at school. Every spare space in the car was used, even around the engine. Wine bottles and Christmas crackers were fitted round the fuel tank, which made Christmas lunch at Fotheringham a spectacular affair when the petrol-soaked crackers were pulled. Scotland was magical. flinging curling stones down bumpy frozen lochs, driving wildly round the estate in a jag that smelled of oil and leather, playing in the massive loft full of generations of memories, and togging up for fancy-dress dinners in the clothes we found there. The other great thing about our car was that I was allowed to drive it from a very young age. Can you imagine the pride, aged about 10, on hearing your father say, "Timmy, can you get the car out, please?" I would rush out, open the garage doors, start the car, back it out 10 yards, turn the wheel, put it in first, drive forward another 10 yards, and stop it outside the front door. I passed my test about a week after my 17th birthday and got my HGV Class 2 licence when I was 23. One of my great regrets is not being a Formula 1 driver. It all started with that beetle. After Rothsay, I went to Berkhamsted Prep and then Junior School. I had a pretty good time, at least until the last year, but my standout memories are of being punished. One teacher was very partial to grabbing chunks of our hair and twisting it until it nearly came out. His other hobby was rapping us hard on the back of the hand with a ruler. The headmaster's beatings had an especially perverse cruelty about them. You would wait on a bench in the table tennis room, which smelled of lino and polish, and be summoned into the headmaster's study, which smelled of pipe smoke and leather. You would then take down your trousers and underpants and bend over the back of a leather armchair and be hit 6 times hard with a cane. I remember him actually saying, "This hurts me more than it does you," and I had to shake his hand at the end and say, "Thank you, sir." The decision to send me to Harrow had a disastrous effect on my last year at Berkhamsted. The norm for the boys was to go from the junior school straight into the senior school, but my parents had other things in mind. I never asked my father about it, and now it's too late. It's not as though he could afford the fees. His salary as an ad man at J. Walter Thompson was ridiculously small, as he never asked for a raise and remained stupidly loyal to them. I believe he got help from richer relations, one of whom admonished me once for not thanking her. I would have done if I'd known. Once my friends found out that I was going to a posh school and was having to take private Latin lessons to get me through common entrance, they ceased to be my friends. I was sent to Coventry, teased, baited, and mentally bullied. The most hurtful thing of all was that my closest friend, a boy called Jeremy, became the ringleader of my tormentors. I used to hide during breaks so they couldn't gang up on me, and no one came to my birthday party that last year. Jeremy and I had acted in lots of school plays together. I distinctly remember the first one, The Dear Departed, by Stanley Houghton, in which we were both playing women. He got a huge laugh when he shot out of the wings and leapt into my arms in fear of being caught by the baddie. It took trust and friendship. After the first night, I went outside to look for my parents, forgetting to take off my makeup, and found myself being noticed by the departing audience. I came back inside and remarked on the attention I was getting. "Oh, I'm not interested in that sort of thing," Jeremy replied superciliously, putting me in my place, and making me wonder if that was the sort of thing that I wanted. 50 years later and still an actor, I suppose the answer must be yes, a bit. The change from best friend to chief tormentor was harsh and cruel, and I never forgave him. His treachery stuck with me for a long time. But when I discovered well into my 40s that he'd been killed in a car accident, I didn't know how to feel. I was shocked and saddened at his death, but selfishly, I also felt cheated of confronting him with his betrayal of our friendship. I'm sure that as an adult he would have apologised and I could have laid that period of my life to rest, but he wasn't able to, so it still hurts. It explains why I was so oversensitive to bullying when my 2 boys were at school, and why I have such a dislike for the cowardice of trolls and cyberbullies today. Another lesson learned at that school was that parents should be very careful about complaining, as it's usually the child who suffers. I once got full marks on a test in maths, which was highly unusual, but I'd done some work for a change. I was accused of cheating, and given 0 out of 10 and a punishment. Upset, I told my mother, who complained bitterly to the teacher. The result was that at the next test, where I got my usual middling marks, the teacher said, Bentinck, 5 out of 10. However, we'd better give you full marks. We don't want your mother complaining again, do we? Bastard.
Harrow School. When my father dropped me off on day one at Harrow in 1966, he remarked, "Hasn't changed much since my time." His time being 1932 to 1937, which meant it hadn't changed much since the 19th century. The main difference, which he never stopped going on about, was that we had central heating, whereas they froze in Harry Potter-like dormitories with open fires and an allowance of about one lump of coal per week. The school is divided up into houses of about 60 boys each. I was in Morton's, which is right smack in the middle, making getting to classrooms a lot easier than for the boys at the end of Harrow Hill. When I arrived, I was put in a room with two other wide-eyed innocents. The houses are like rabbit warrens with bits added on over the centuries, so that finding my way around took months to learn. This made responding to boy calls even harder. The fagging system at Harrow was complex, but more or less phased out by the time I left. This was annoying because I willingly submitted to being treated like a virtual slave for my first year, only because I knew that when I got to be a sixth former, I too would have someone to clean my shoes, make my tea, go shopping, run errands, clean my room, and generally do as they're told. I had to do all that shit and never got to dole it out later. Those were private fags. A boy call was made by a sixth former whose private fag was out or unavailable, and it went like this. Said sixth former stands outside his room and shouts, "Boy, boy, boy, boy," upon which anyone in their first year has to drop what they're doing, or, if they're on the bog, stop mid-effort, and run at full speed through the warren of corridors to where the shouting is coming from. Last boy there gets the job. This explains why I and my contemporaries were highly skilled at leaping down an entire flight of stairs in one go and tended to win at rugby. I can't say that I hated Harrow. I made some very good friends, some of whom remain dear to me to this day. My mum took her own life just after my first term at boarding school. Maybe she wasn't too keen on the last of her children leaving home and was alone and sad. It was tough. But those friends helped me through, especially Noel Diacono, who was my new roommate that term. He was essentially brutal and didn't allow me time to wallow in sadness, but he knew what he was doing. Now in our 60s, he's the brother I never had. I once read a psychiatrist saying that 5 years at a boys' boarding school does untold psychological damage, ruins sex lives, screws up a man's ability to have relationships, and triggers a budding psychopath into full-on barking lunacy. Well, no one who decides to be an actor can be described as completely normal, but I seem to have survived, if not unscathed, then just about able to cope. Part of the reason for that has been the love of my older sisters, Sorrel and Anna, whom I adore. An easy and happy life with my mother in the short time I had with her. A close relationship with my father. Then, later, the incredible luck of meeting my beloved Judy when I was 21. And the joy of bringing up our amazing boys, Willem and Jasper. I perfectly understand why some people think of boys who went to places like Harrow and Eton as out-of-touch, privileged toffs without a care in the world. Funnily enough, that's exactly what we thought of Etonians. Most of my friends' parents weren't rich, but had scrimped and saved from fairly modest middle-class incomes to send their sons there, and had nothing left over for any luxuries. That's not to say that some kids weren't minted, but, as a rule, the brash kids tended to be disliked, and it was considered bad form to boast of wealth. Of course, everything is relative, and we had no understanding of real poverty or suffering. The only ethnic minorities we ever met were African or Arab princes and kings, and a lot of boys were picked up at the end of term in Bentleys and Jags, although my pa brilliantly used to turn up in winter in his rusty convertible Beetle with the hood down, long white hair and beard flowing, wearing a black eye patch, and his grandfather's Canadian raccoon skin coat with massive furry collar turned up. Sports were an important part of life at Harrow. I was quite good at most sports, but not outstanding.
The one thing at which I excelled was swimming. I learned how to swim fast from Pa, who had the most graceful freestyle stroke. And it is written of my great-uncle Henry, who died at the Somme, that to witness Bentinck off the high board was worth travelling miles to see, according to the school magazine, The Harrovian. The Harrow Pool was called Ducker, as it used to be a duck pond. Before it was abandoned in the 70s, it was the longest outdoor private pool in Europe, some 250 yards long, incorporating a 50-yard racing section, and was unheated. It was here that my father found himself in the 30s swimming naked against the Hitler Youth. Swimming trunks were only made compulsory in the late 1950s when they built the nearby hospital that overlooks the pool. During the war, my father was comforted by the knowledge that extremely cold water has the same shriveling effect on a Nazi as it does on a Harrovian. It was inspiring to find in the changing rooms one's own father's name carved on the wooden boards for cups and prizes won, and I set out to emulate him. I was used to cold water, as our local pool, the Deer Leap in Little Gadsden, was an unheated outdoor lido. Blissful on summer days, but so cold it made your head ache if you swam too fast. The Berkhamsted School pool, by contrast, was indoor, heated, and only 25 yards long. I'd been swimming captain there, and also had the school underwater distance record. So I arrived at Harrow thinking I was the bee's knees. I had a rude awakening. One 50-yard length of the pool, in near-freezing water, was a massive shock to the system, but probably explained why the school won everything. We just wanted to get out of the bloody water as soon as we could. I was the fastest boy ever to swim in that pool, as I still held the individual medley and freestyle records when they shut it down and built an indoor replacement. I also swam the last ever length there, when, many years later, my dear friend Noel and I, on a nostalgic, alcohol-fueled ramble about the old place, scrambled through undergrowth to find the pool ruinous, abandoned, but so full of memories. There was about 3 feet of rainwater, so I stripped off to the buff and swam the last length. My great-uncle had spent his final week's leave from the front at the pool, so there was a palpable sense of sadness and closure in that act. Having a cool dad but having lost my mum, being a swimmer and a smoker, the two went inextricably together, being not great at footy but a demonic tackler, playing the guitar, having a tuck box full of Mr. Kipling's almond slices, probably the most delicious thing ever made, left over from one of Pa's advertising shoots, doing modern languages, these things made me accepted, in such relieving contrast to the tormented, excluded year I'd come from. Of course I look back now with rose-tinted glasses, but there were satisfying moments, including getting into a bath full of hot, muddy water after freezing games of rugby or Harrow football, then having tea and toast before setting off in the dark for more lessons, bruised and bleeding, but wrapped up in the traditional long Harrow scarf. In a perverse way, the feeling of having survived without having any limbs ripped off was a good one. And Ducker was magical, beautiful, serene. When we weren't racing or diving, there were log mills. A mill is a fight, and a log is a log. There were logs floating in the water, and teams of about 20 boys would fight each other to get a log to their side of the pool. The log had splinters. The pool was rough concrete, and, like so many things which wouldn't be allowed today, it was great. As the sun set, we'd walk back to the hill, avoiding the cowpats on the football fields that were grazed by Frisians, munching our ducker biscuits, huge rich tea wheels that cost a penny each, and a Coke that was sixpence, bought from the small hatch in the door of the pool keeper's cottage, run by Mr. Campkin, who had been there in my father's day and remembered his swimming. Mr. Campkin had treasures of chocolate inside, which you could just see through the hatch but could only afford on special occasions. Glowing and exhausted, we walked across fields and up to our rooms in the huge houses on top of the hill. All of that was pretty blissful. On the other hand, I was pretty much constantly homesick. I just counted down the days until I could go home. There was a thing called exeat weekends, when our parents would come and collect us on Friday night and we had to be back on Sunday evening. Even the word evening felt like a very grown-up luxury to be allowed back so late. I would feel the joy of release on the Friday night when I'd hear from way up the road the sound of the familiar VW engine of my childhood come gurgling round the corner, and I'd rush down with my bag and leap in the car before Pa had hardly stopped, and we'd be away from what was essentially a prison term, locked up in a building, with no choice but to stay, beaten if we misbehaved, made to attend classes, chapel and cadet force, required to wear starched collar and tails, compulsory exercise, no drinking, no girls, no smoking. No wonder we wanted to go home. In the first summer holiday after Mum died, my father borrowed a Comma camper van, and we set off together to tour around Eastern Europe. I never asked him why, but I imagine it was a desire for a father-son bonding exercise, and guilt about my parents' deteriorating relationship, which had contributed to my mum's depression and suicide. That summer, I wrote a poem that began, "I went round Eastern Europe in a comma with my dad. It was 1967. My mum had gone to heaven. We saw the sights in black and white, and both of us were feeling, understandably, quite sad." It was an odd trip to take in the years of the Cold War. East Germany, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Austria, Switzerland, and back through France. We had an amazing 1960s Philips Mignon portable record player that purported to play 45s on the move. It was very futuristic, as you slid the record in like a modern car CD player, and it had dampers to stop it jumping. My pa used to like to play Scott McKenzie's San Francisco, Be Sure to Wear Flowers in Your Hair, because it filled him with hope for a better post-war future run by peace-loving hippies. I got into trouble for leaving the discs on the dashboard in the sun, and they all warped, except Nancy Sinatra's You Only Live Twice. I wrote in the poem, "Of all the songs that melted in the dormobile that day, the one song that survived it was the one that made him cry, the one I'd brought when he'd asked not, the Bond theme about living twice, because my mother hadn't." Memories of that trip include his outrage at having a massive military bayonet confiscated at the East German border, doing black market cash deals with a Polish woman in a petrol station toilet, me being pulled off the roof of the camper as I took photographs of Soviet troops parachuting into the Danube, and pouring water from the sink into the radiator, the engine was between the front seats, as we puffed and steamed our way over the Alps. Happier times with my father were spent at home and abroad on the film sets for the TV commercials he produced for J. Walter Thompson. These included ads for Mother's Pride, with Dusty Springfield, Joe Brown and Andy Stewart, and Mr. Kipling. It was Pa who wrote the lines, "Mr. Kipling makes exceedingly good cakes," and cast the inimitable voice of James Hayter. These days, TV commercials don't generate the iconic status that they used to, but back then, some ads became part of the national consciousness. If you say to anyone of my generation, "Do you remember the Nimble Balloon adverts?" they will nearly all say yes. The strapline was, "Real bread, but lighter." Bingo, thought Pa. Strap it to a balloon. Expanding on this idea, he imagined a girl eating a nimble sandwich in a balloon basket with a beautiful Spanish castle in the background. Why a Spanish castle? Probably because Pa fancied a trip to Spain. In those pre-green screen days, and with massive budgets, films were made in exotic locations simply for the jolly, which is how he found himself in Segovia with a hydrogen balloon, a film crew, and me. It was an amazing adventure for a 14-year-old. And it's probably why I feel so at home.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.